Welcome to the Totally Awesome Fishing Show, where I'm going out fishing, sea fishing, but listen, it's just to try and tell you, you don't always need to go aboard a huge boat, a fast boat, anything like that. As long as you're on the water safely, you can get some good fishing in. Now, a lot of big boats that are on, what we should say, wet moorings, they're moorings that are out there permanently floating, they're tied up to buoys, people need to get what's called a tender, which is a small rowing boat with a tiny outboard, to be able to get out to their yacht, to their fishing boat, to their cruise or whatever. Now they're only tiny, these boats, they've invariably got a small, you know, horse outboard on the back of them, or even just a pair of oars. But you can still catch fish in those. Now I'm down here on the Lizard Peninsula, at a place called, a little known place called St. Anthony's Bay. It's absolutely beautiful on good weather, it's idyllic, you wouldn't want to be anywhere else. It's got a big creek, you can go up in the creek, right up in the creek, you know, at low water. And as that fills, you'll start to get mullet coming in there, and all around people are coming out now. This is sort of late morning, they're coming out to get aboard their boats to go out yachting, cruising, whatever. But I'm Totally Awesome Fishing Show and I am going fishing. Now I'm going to take some light rods out with me, fingers crossed we might even get to show you something, but more important, I'm going to try and get you an echo sounder survey, which as far as I know has never been done before, of a bass mark that we call the Nair Point. Now we fished it enough years down here with Brian Gardner, who runs a boat, a 19 footer called the Amarilla. It's right behind me there, and we've been out, we caught sharks in it and conger in it and everything. But this is a tiny boat we've got here. This is just an 8 foot tender with a giant horse on the back. Two horses in fact, just a 2 horsepower outboard, and I've got my oars as backup. Now, on your own, in a small boat, generally no problems, but wear a life preserver. I'm not going to call this a life jacket because people will be saying, oh, it's not a life jacket, it's a life preserver. I call it a buoyancy aid. I think that's correct. So it's a buoyancy aid. They're nice and loose. You can fall in the water, they automatically inflate. More accidents happen at sea, as far as I'm told anyway, getting from the dry ground to the boat. People fall in the water, and yes, I'm told more accidents happen getting from the ground out to the boat on the water than anywhere else. Well, that's where most people fall in the water, isn't it? So if you fall in the water, it doesn't matter if it's 6 feet. If it's only 6 feet and I'm 5'8", oh dear, blub, blub, blub. Unless you can swim or you wear one of these buoyancy aids. Youngsters want to go out in boats like this. Now, mum and dad think, oh, I'll give them a little boat. It won't cost very much. And it's true, you can set yourself up for quite good value. But try and get one that's a decent. This has got quite a hard skin bottom. I think it might be double skin, this one. Because when you're launching off the shore, you're going to grind it across gravel, shingle, boulders, stones. It's going to take a bit of a battering. So you want one that can take a bit of a battering. So my suggestion is, I'm not plugging any mates, I wouldn't even know the makes. Get one that's a good GRP, a good glass, a good build, what they term in the boating industry as a well laid up boat. Now then, the other thing is, you might think it's fun if your youngsters to want to go out in a boat, 3, 4, 5, don't do that. Don't go out in bulk, maybe 2 people maximum. I know there's 3 seats. You want one for rowing, you want one for sitting at, one for somebody else at the front. Don't mess about, don't jump in boats, don't jump out of boats, don't stand up in boats if you can help it. Yes, I've done it, I've stood up in boats, and I shall probably at some stage stand up in this one today. Now, that's a sort of health and safety aspect. It's all common sense, but such a beautiful setting. You want to live to see it, don't you, for goodness sake? Look at it, don't fall in the water unless you're a brilliant swimmer. Right, let's look at this little setup with a Lowrance outfit. Now I'm going to do this little talk for you while I'm tied up to Brian's boat here, Amarilla, because I'm right in the estuary. I might get wind in the mic, I might wobble. And to be honest, if I get out there by the Nair, we've had bass here before, I might get some pollock, I might get mackerel, I might get garfish. Once I start fishing, all this is done. Now this is a unit that you can buy for small boats obviously going further offshore, but I'm going to try it on this small little tender, this 8-footer. Okay, so it comes in its own, I suppose, spray-proof bag. It's portable, but inside, I'll just show you here, it's got its own battery, so you can come on a small boat like this, just plug it in, and it comes with a lead and a transducer with a sucker cup there that I can just suck on the back of the boat I'm going along. So it's got its own transducer. This is the main unit. This is called an Elite 4 HDI, okay? It's a very good little sound. It's very popular with kayakers, this model, but it's popular with a lot of small boaters. But being portable, you can take it around, and if you use it on your big boat, great, but if you want a day out just for a bit of fun, you can actually use them on these small rowing boats, tenders, 8-footers, 9-footers, like that. So I'm going to plug this one in, set it up, but more important with this one, what it does, it actually has a facility to record your sonar soundings, and it also has a facility to record the composite of the bottom, so it can tell you what the weed bed's like, the vegetation, hard rock, sand, that sort of thing. Now, I'm no expert in this. Anybody who's watched our Totally Awesome Films knows that for sure. I'm going to give it a go. I'm going to try and set this up, and I'm going to round there, because the tide's low at the moment, so this will be a low water reading, about an hour up, and see if we can't get some sort of sonar reading on a spot. And I know the rough area within 100 yards where the bass are. I can normally see it on Brian's Echo Sounder in the big boat, but very interested to see what this thing can record. Let's get it set up. Okay, we're all set up. You probably won't see it in the sun, in the glare, but there's the sounder. I've got it all set up on sound. And now all you need to do with these is you scroll through pages, you go into your pages, you select what you want, and then you'll have a log sonar button. So I can actually physically watch where I'm going over this reef out. It's very, very shallow water reef. I can watch where I'm going, and also it records a sonar, and then that will store that in there. I can take it out in the memory card, take it home, and then put it into Insight Genesis, and we'll see what sort of survey we get. And obviously, I'm going to be fishing as well. I'm going to try and stick a rod out. I've only got short spinning rods. If you're in a tiny boat, you want obviously little tiny rods, little small rods, 6 foot or something like that. And fixed spool reels, because I can put them on a bait runner, and the trusty red gill. I'm just using a red gill sand eel, unweighted. You don't want those weighted ones for this shallow water fishing. And as we're trolling along, recording this sonar, I'm going to be pulling one of these behind me, and also the larger size one there, my trusty black one, which I use offshore in the deep waters, but I've also had bass in shallow water. I'm on 15 pound line straight through, but what I actually do is I tie a barrel swivel about 6 or 8 feet up the line, up here. Can't see it, it's out of the picture. Up here, trust me, it's there. Then what happens, because there's weed floating in the water, any weed catches on the line, it slides down, it stops on that swivel, it doesn't go down and cover the lure. If you get weed of any description over the lure, the fish won't take it. So it's not a big fishing expedition. I might get lucky with something. It's more to record this survey on the bass mark up there, so you've got something, and you'll have figures there that you can look at yourself. But you never know. If you think Totally Awesome aren't putting a rod and bait in the water, think again. Guys, I'm in all sorts of trouble. I've just had a double hookup on bass. I can't believe it. I've got bass two at a time on here. I've had to kill the engine. I'm drifting across the reef, and I think with the tide here. My God, can you believe it? Just came out here to do the echo sounding. Do I care if the echo sound is working? No! Oh my God, I think I'm going to stay on. I'm in a real mess. The rod's falling to pieces. I bought my rubbishy rods. Oh, it's a nice bass. I don't know which one to get first, guys. I think the back one is slightly smaller. I'm going to go for this one. No landing net again. Oh, look at this. Don't fall off for the guys at YouTube. Please don't fall off. Oh, no. Ah! I love it. I love it when a plan comes together. Especially when I didn't even plan it. Look at that bass. I mean, what a place. Is that worth recording this reef? Look, I'm not going to say we've got the best conditions, but it just goes to show, people say you'll never catch bass with the sun out. And I went to Ireland once and I caught bass in blazing sunshine off the shore. Only two of them. It's in one of our videos. Look at that fish. I think I feel I might have to keep this one for Uncle Brian, who lent me the boat, because he loves eating bass. And they are indeed a fine eating fish. And this one is well in the taking size, that one. Look at that. What a session. A double strike on bass, running into the tide. Get myself tangled up. And that one just goes to show you, it doesn't make any difference what they take. That one took my favourite huge size. Well, it's not huge size, regular size. Red gill, black. And the other one took the miniature size. Please stay on. Here he comes, here he comes, here he comes. A double strike on bass, man. Don't fall off, don't fall off, don't fall off, small hook. Success in every packet was totally awesome. Not quite as big as the other one. This guy's going to get returned. Look at that, folks. That is totally awesome sounder recording. Let's get him off the hook. A nice bass, a nice bass. Just going to hold him by the jaw, pop him off. Look, there you go. That's a size eel. What a beauty. And here's a rarity. It's going to get returned. His pal, on the other hand, is on a one-way trip to the grill. Just so you guys know, that was pulling into the tide. Okay, so here's the reef coming around like this, the current's sweeping all the food down here, and those fish are sitting on the down tide side of that reef, waiting for particles of food to come through, and I've probably pulled across their face with the red gills going like that. So as it's pulled across their face, bang, and tell you what, two fishers. Well, that's a few years since I've had a double strike down at Nair Point on bass. Don't tell anybody this is a good bass mark. Actually, don't tell them about the red gills. But it's got to be unweighted, guys. It's got to be unweighted. There you go. And see what I mean about the weed? That swivel stops any weed going on there. Let's get this old engine started. Please start, please start. Fingers crossed, see if Uncle Brian's had it serviced. Good old Uncle Brian. And we're still sonar logging. I'm going to do that run again. On bait runners, I put the bait runner on, and if I don't, because I can't see when I'm steering, these are a nightmare to steer. If I let go of the tiller, it's flying off all over the place, as you can see. So I've got it on the bait runner, I'm drying it, the sonar logging. I'm still in 8 feet of water here. 8 feet of water, two bass. Gotta love it, folks. Small boat fishing. I hate this tiller, it's driving me mad. Stop it, don't stall, don't stall. Don't you dare stall. What a son of a bitch. Guys, I've pretty well finished that logging, all that sonar logging now, and I really got lucky with those two bass. But although I finished logging, I put the anchor down, I've come off the edge of that reef, and I found on there a couple of great big lumps of rock, about 300 yards off the Nair, I guess about due east. I'm going to anchor up here, chill out. I'm going to chuck a couple of baits down. I've got no mackerel, I've got no fresh bait, all I've got is some squid. I'll put some squid out and just see if using that sonar, the marks I found on there are worth stopping. So I've done the bass, got lucky with those, logged the sonar hopefully, and now by using that sounder, I've learned some other little places here, about the size of the boat, you know, big boulders. And I'm anchored hopefully upcoming from, there's about an hour left to high water. Then I've got an hour of slack, so I know the bass are going to shut down. I figure it's worth a shot, lay down, chill out, put some squid baits on the bottom. Well guys, I lost one big conger on that big rock, anchored up. I've waited for the tide to start. I've gone to finish some more sonar on the outside and I've got another bass. I've seen him busting on the surface as well. Don't fall off, he's inhaled it. There we go. Another bass, and he sucked that red gill right back. He swallowed that one. What a session. Three bass, one conger lost, and I'm only supposed to be coming out here doing sonars. Ouch. And obviously watch the spines on bass. There we go, guys. Not gonna set the world alight. Let's get him back. I've got to have one more pull through. What a day's fishing. Well, how lucky was that little survey trip out in an 8-foot dinghy? Not only did I get to do some survey work, I actually got to catch three bass. And I lost a conger as well. Good conger on the bottom as well. Anchoring. Oh, well, there you go. You obviously think I had a good time, don't you? Yes, yes. Was he really surveying, or is it just an excuse to go fishing? No, I've got you now, because I've actually got the survey on the computer. You want to see what the seabed looks like off the Nair Point? Should I tell you, YouTubers? Why not? Share and share alike. Trust me, I'm not sharing my best fishy marks, but this one, I don't mind. I think everybody knows about it anyway. Come and have a look, join me, follow me to the computer, and I'll actually show you what I did get surveyed. Now, I am balanced rather precariously here on the edge of a chair because I've had to put the camera in the prime position in front of the screen, but here it gives you an idea. This is what the InSight Genesis has pulled up from the survey. Now, this is a split screen. You can see on the right here, if you follow the mouse as best you can, hopefully you can, you've got the sounder readings. And here, for those who don't know, is a map of the world, or my side of the world, as I call it, America, good old England. There's the dot that I recorded. So we've got Spain, all of Europe around here, so is Africa. Everybody internationally know where this place is that I've surveyed. So I'm just going to keep just pulling in the map, dragging it across until people realise where in England I was fishing. You can see, here's England, here's Ireland. Great fishing just there, Cork McSherry. Down here in this southwest peninsula we got here in England, there can be some pretty good fishing. And as I go in closer, just so that people know exactly where it is, the island's off the toe there. I'm going to keep zooming in slowly. Just here are the Isles of Scilly. Here is Land's End. It's called Land's End for the reason that it is the end of England on the southwest peninsula. Now here, all in here, this is sort of Falmouth Bay area. I'm keep going to pull it in. Now, let me just show you roughly so people know where we are. Up here is Falmouth Bay, one of the deepest harbours we had. Used a lot in the Second World War. Big marine area here. And obviously the urbanised area is grey there. I normally launch my shark boat up here somewhere, Mylon Marine. I bring it out this way. Let's push it up. Now, a famous area coming out into Falmouth Bay is the Helford River estuary here. You can see there, it's a very, very famous area. Beautiful scenery around there, because this is all protected. If I just give people a rough idea, they don't probably realise it. But this area here is the Lizard Peninsula that sticks out. So you cut a line across from there to there, and this is what's called the Lizard. So some good fishing down there, just so you know exactly where we're talking about. So I'm going to pull it in, but although you've got here, you can see the Helford River. What a lot of people don't realise is there's this other secret one here. St. Anthony Bay, just around this headland, there's the Helford, come out of the Helford, tuck around into St. Anthony Bay. Now, if I just pop in there, just briefly, you'll see this is at low water. And this is quite handy because that's when I actually did the sounder from low water about an hour up, didn't I? I said I was about an hour into it, maybe 1.5 hours. You can see there, there's the mudflats.
There's the mudflats. There's a feeder channel going along that feeds in. There's a little boat to give you an idea here. That's the feeder channel. I'll pull it along. It then splits into two other channels. And you can, at high water, actually take a small dinghy up there and you can fish for stuff like small, tiny little bass and mullet. It splits and it goes back into a join. Here's the main part of St. Anthony Bay, which everybody knows. This is where I launch a little dinghy from. And then, if I just pull back a bit, it's where we go out to sea. Now you can see here, this is where I started the track log. That's where I started with the Lowland Sounder. Started up there and putted my way around here. There's a little reef goes out of the water here, so all boaters be aware there is a reef there. Bear in mind, this is low water. Now, you should be able to see here from this bay, a peninsula going out quite a way there, sticking out from that segmented area of fields here, cliffs, etc. You can't really get down there. Well, I suppose you could rappel down there if you're a rock climber. But that's where I was fishing, backwards and forwards around that peninsula. I'm going to pull it in a little bit more, just centralise it. Now, I'm no techno wizard here, so you'll have to live with me. Now, some of you might actually notice, here's the green of the grass. That's the hard land. This is low water. I cannot echo sound this because I'd need to be walking around with the echo sounder in my hand. It is bone dry. The tide is out. However, you can see from the picture here, there is the circular Coast Guard lookout point, station, whatever you want to call it, of Nare Point. This is Nare Point. Okay, so at high water, the water will be covered over here. That's why there's not much showing around here, because you can see this is as close as I can get, short of running aground. There ain't no water there, ladies. I've been as close as I can in that boat to try and get this for you. I'm going to pull it back just a tad there, okay? So this is my track. This is where the boat's been. The red dot here, just there, so you can see it, is where the boat's logged. Let me show you again. If I say pop on, let's say there, need to be quite precise. We saw it move right. That line there, or that line there, equates over here on the right to the echo sounder that I made. Now it's very, very shallow there, so you have got a lot of noise, a lot of interference there, and perhaps maybe perchance I might not have had it on the right setting for such shallow water with weed, because there is weed there. But you can see it's very, very pinnacly. Now if I just pull that across, and I pull the screen up a bit, you might be able to see. Just there, it's got track. Now, if I pop that track off, you can see it's just the dot where the boat is at the present time. Well, it's not there, Graham. It's up in the harbour. Don't be silly, man. The boat is there on this particular picture at that particular moment in time. If I come further up to where it says contours, I click on contours, I've got intervals in feet there. Now, if I click on 1 foot, contours every 1 foot, watch this one, ladies, this is good. Show contours. It generates that lot. Now, that's far more interesting, I think you'll agree. But what I did find, and I've fished here for several years, if we pulled the lines, we trolled up and down this side, pretty well on any state of tide, that was a good taking area for bass. However, if we went this way, from about here, there's the Coast Guard station, so almost due north from the Coast Guard station, that way we didn't get, well, rarely got the bass strikes there. You can see a deep area here, and across here, you can see it drops away there. But look at the contours all around here, the closeness of the lines there. Look, we're down to a couple of feet, 3 feet, 2 or 3 feet there. You can see all those contours there, how tightly they are. But we used to pick quite a lot of bass up. It was just around the corner here, on the turn, before we turned and ran, you know, made another run back towing the eels, just around there. And I always fancied that on an ebb tide, because the tide hits this headland here and it sucks around here, comes all over these, you know, these rock marks, these lots of gullies and channels and boulders. You can see it's strewn with different ups and downs and everything. That's presumably why it's good for bass there. But by pulling around this corner, I can now see, look, this comes right up here. And when I'm down here, which is when I used to get the takes, my lines were back there, pulling over the top of those boulders. And that's presumably where the small fish and sand eels, general bait fish, got pushed down on the tide there. So I've actually learned something. Hey, there's something there that is very, very interesting. Now, if I put the track back on, well, let me just show you then another point. You can go into contours. It doesn't show a lot here. Vegetation is the green, well, it's seaweed, so it's going to be green, isn't it? It would be different in deeper water. And composition, wow, look at the different composition. Now, this is a different hardness of the rocks and boulders there. So you can see a huge difference between the reds, the sort of tan beige colours, and the very light colours. Different hard boulders. You know, this one, I would imagine, is one there that at a low water spring does actually show. It does show. So you can go, don't go too close to that on a boat. You have to go, you know, and use your eye looking for waves. And here, these two come very shallow. Okay. So what we could do is if we go back to, yeah, we're back on the contours. We're going to show those contours and leave that on the contours of 1 foot. Okay. I'm going to change that back to contours only. I'm going to bring my track back there. There's my track. Now, if I put my track, let's say, there. I'm going to be quite precise on these to get it there. It jumps it, but I know it's on there then. Drag the screen back. I'm going to pull it up a little bit here. Over on the right, I've got a stop button, a regular speed, and a fast forward there. Now, you can see all these ups and downs. Where we are right there, that dot there is what's underneath the boat there exactly. I'm going to run it. I'm going to run this at a speed. Now, over on the left here, you'll notice me going around in that little putt-putt engine and the sounder. And every time I go over something high, look how it peaks here, all right, on the sounder on the chart here. Up and down and up and down. So that also equates between the two. Now, let's say we're going to go along and you find a fish, which you might, now they could be small fish down the back here. They could be small fish down the back. They might be small pollock. Now that there, stop. See this little mark here? That could be a bass or it could be a pollock. So I'm going to go along, stop right over it. I'm right over where it is. So if you found a spot on the Nair or indeed anywhere and you thought, my God, I wish I'd known that fish was there at the time, because you might not have been looking at the sounder at that time. You can't look at it all the time. You're fishing as well. But this is a benefit. You can come back and you can put it in your computer, play around at home, right? Now I think, right, how do I find that spot again? Well, you know, you just look for where the boat is. Here's the boat here, okay? There's the boat there. Boom, click there, okay? And when you look down the bottom, I'm going to do it with my finger so I don't move those numbers. Here you go, lat 50.086004, longitude 5.074956. So you make a note of those, you log them into your plotter, into your GPS, because you can put this all back in the GPS, you know, if you don't want to do it this way. And then, you know, that spot there, this rock, remember here, is never going to move. Now the fish probably will, but if you did want to go to back a good fishing spot, you use this to find that area there for fish. And you can log that number down. I'm going to keep running it forward. You can see I'm going right past the front of the Nair. And look, all this on the surface there, where it shallows right up here. You see off the peninsula? It shallows right up. I'm in 7.65. I'm nearly 3 feet of water there. I'm almost suicidal there. This is turbulence as well as weed going through where the current's running. And then back down here, look at all this. This would undoubtedly be weed, I would say, down there. But we've never found anything that way. And I think because the weed is there, the bass aren't there. I think, if I put a stop on that for a second, that the bass, when we get takes, are somewhere like there. Now, this is much harder contour. I'm going to run it again. That's fish, by the way, there. Harder contour. Look how it drops off. That could be weed. That could be fish. But much harder contour. Up and down here on the right, I'm looking. So you can see less weed growth. Much, much harder rock. Big drop there. Big pinnacles. It's some good area for fishing. There's some fish. Bang. I've stopped it. 1, 2, 3, 4. There's markings there. They might be fish. They might not. I'm going to pull that screen up for you just so you can see those longs and lats there. Just in here. So as the boat's running up and down there, that's how it, obviously you can pick up your number. So I just stopped there a second. I'm going to put the cursor just here. Come on, get on there. There he is, he jumps there. That's a good place I've got the bass, on the ebb tide, and pulled the lures right the way down here. My boat would be somewhere about here when I make the turn, but my lures might be 60 to 80 yards back. And that's where I used to get a lot of bass, and indeed all the way up across this contour here. So if I just tweak that up here, give it a run, you can see, although it's very, very shallow here, There's definitely, there's weed, there's sand, there's different type of contour. It's up and down. This one here is probably weed. That, I'm guessing, is weed on the top. That's just from experience. But if I just go stop and I pop it up here on that track, there, and I run that one, this is a much harder defined area. And if I even go over here, which is deeper water, look at the clarity there, and who knows what these marks are. They could be bass, they could be pollock. You know, I have a lot of feeling a lot of these fish arches are bass on the surface, and on an ebb tide, with the tide coming this way, if I pull my lures all around this area, I could pick some of these fish off. Now, some will be rubbish, some will not be fish, but look at, there's a lot of activity in the top 7.2. Let's say the first 7 feet of water, and that's why I believe I catch on a regular sandal, fished on the surface. Okay, now here's something else you can do. You can actually have more than one go at this. You can go out on one day, you can go out in the morning, you can go out in the afternoon, you can do your track logs. If you go out over 2 or 3 days, or indeed any time, you might go back here a month later and fish. If you put that same sonar recording to log the sonar, when you come back, you're going to have a second map, aren't you? We can actually go into here and you can double up and you can get a merge maps section where you can put all your sounder readers together. So where I might have missed out here, yeah, you can see there's a boat over here as well. Where I've missed, say, out there, then you can still come back in, and if you go out in that area, it will merge it and add it, and you can actually build this map up bigger and bigger and bigger, not just over this particular area that I am. So that gives you some sort of guide or idea, you know, what can actually happen when you go out and you do your recordings. Just pull that one up again, from 3 feet to 1 foot. This is a merge map, by the way. This is more than one, okay? This is more than one, but you can see I've pulled up here. If you can see this on the outside, I've gone all in here where the deep water is. I've actually done a lot more surveying, and that's on the track out. Out and back one day, out and back, out and back. So you're gradually building up. Depth's different, 17. You can see the deep channel here, darker, 21, 25 feet. And then as you come towards the near point here, you can see all the contours closing up. Where it closes, it gets shallower and shallower and shallower. And way over here, you can see that one there. In here, look, lots and lots of different ground and deeper holes. So I can now see where I've merged two trips together. Loads of detail, loads, even down to little small spots that I hadn't picked up on that first one. So you can pick those up. So this is a main screen. It's not the split screen with the sounder reading on it. It's a merged trip, but it gives you an idea. And I think you can see the Coast Guard, you can't miss that. Just around here, and especially up and down this side, way down, you can see why the bass are there. Exactly why bass and pollock are in this area. It's where all the food gets washed all around the shelves, the rocks, the boulders. And do you know what? If I can keep doing surveying like this, it provides interest for me. What else it provides is bass. It provides me with some nice bass as well. Put your bass back when you can. Keep the odd one for the table, sure. But you don't have to keep them all. Let's put some back for another day. Hope you enjoyed it. It's only a small boat, a little 8-foot dinghy. But I've made a survey with it, and I've caught bass in the same day. Good fishing, guys, and keep watching the Totally Awesome Fishing Show.